Good morning and welcome to Unity of Port St. Lucie and our YouTube Sunday service. This morning we're joined by Reverend Vernell Nelson. She begins a three-week series this morning entitled How to Let God Help You. This morning's message is titled Our True Purpose. And we begin our service this morning with One Light. Thank you, Jeff. Thank you, Linda. And if you would now just relax back in your seats, clear your mind, and consider these words from our prayer for inner peace. I open my heart and mind this morning to the presence of God that is within me and in everyone and everything. That one power and one presence, I let God's peaceful fill my being in this presence. I am peaceful, poised, confident and strong. I relax in God's loving care and release all my cares, knowing that God is upholding me and sustaining me in all that I do. God's presence calms me, quiets the storms around me, and leads me to a place of perfect peace. As I center myself in that peaceful presence this morning, I let go of every concern and relax in the safety of God's love and in the love of those around me. I find Unity of Port St. Lucie a sanctuary of love and peace, and I am open and receptive to all it has to offer and soothe my mind and soul this day. And so it is. Amen. This morning's daily word will be read by Linda Woodcox.
Good morning. The daily word for today, Sunday, May 17th, is let go, let God. I let go and trust the divine in me. When faced with a decision to make, do my thoughts turn immediately to divine guidance, or do I seek God's help only when all else fails? Unity co-founder Charles Fillmore wrote that God loves to be used, and the more you use him, the more easily you use him, and the more pleasant his help becomes. God lives in me and expresses through me. All of the attributes of God are as near as my next thought. I release my attachment to limited human reasoning. I center my mind and heart on the constant flow of divine love, wisdom, understanding, and strength. In the divine flow, I find answers to questions. New possibilities for the good emerge. I move forward with confidence. And from Deuteronomy 4:29, from there you will seek the Lord your God, and you will find him if you search after him with all your heart and soul. Be safe.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel God's mighty power and God's grace. with your eyes gently closing and your feet flat on the floor. Open your hands and rest them gently, palms up on your lap, and feel the presence of the Almighty. Feel the presence of the Almighty. And as you pray in the silence, know this truth. As you say these words silently to yourself, my purpose is simple. I complicate things unnecessarily when I seek to analyze everything and everyone around me. Analyze every little comment. I fearfully assume that my job is enormous and that I cannot achieve my goals. The truth is, I do not have a grand assignment. My only assignment is one very small task, that is to think in love, to act in love, and to speak in love. Spirit has not called upon me to solve all the problems of the world, nor to negotiate a truce in a feud that has lasted for generations. In doing the work that I have been called to do, these things are resolved. They are resolved first on the spiritual plane and then in the natural. I am a vessel filled with the grace of the indwelling Christ, following guidance from Holy Spirit, following the path of peace and the path of unconditional love, lighting the way to truth, lighting the way to peace, lighting the way to harmony, lighting the way to God. And I reflect upon and resonate this truth in the silence. And now, as I gently allow my consciousness to return to this present time and to this physical space, I allow my Christ-light to illumine those with whom I come into contact. I leave this place knowing that we are one, and in this oneness with Jesus the Christ, I am the light of the world. I am a beacon of light and love. I am a beacon of healing. I am a beacon of abundance. I am a beacon of joy. I am a beacon of peace. I am one with the Christ. I am one with the Creator. I am one with the universe. I am one with all of humanity, and in this oneness, I declare that I honor, bless, and see the Christ in all living things. And I do this in the name and the nature and the power of the indwelling Christ. Amen and amen. Well, good morning. It's always good to be with my friends. And I really consider you family here in Port St. Lucie. God bless you. I pray that each and every one of you and all of your loved ones continue to be safe and healthy. So today, we're going to be talking about a book that was written by Myrtle Fillmore called How to Let God Help You. Now, we're not only going to be talking about it today, but we're also going to be talking about it for the next two Sundays. This is a three-part series. Today, we're going to be looking at our true purpose. But before we get into our talk, I just want to let you know a little bit about the book. How to Let God Help You was written by Myrtle Fillmore, but it was not published until 1956, which was about 25 years after she made her transition. This is her third book. The first two books I think you might be familiar with. The first one is Myrtle Fillmore's Healing Letters. The second one was We Wisdom Way. If you're at all familiar with Myrtle Fillmore and her work with Unity, you know that We Wisdom was a series of books and teachings for young people that she was greatly involved with during her lifetime. Now this book, How to Let God Help You, actually comes from three different sources. The first source is a collection of letters that were written by Myrtle Fillmore that represent the finest expressions of her personal spiritual consciousness. The second source is a survey of early Unity literature containing spiritual practical suggestions in columns that were written by Myrtle Fillmore in the late 18th century and the early 20th century. And the third source came from a sealed envelope that was not discovered until after her transition. It was found in her effects, and it contained lectures that she delivered during the summer of 1890. Now, while the first edition was published in 1956, the second edition was not published until 1994, and her granddaughter, Rosemary Fillmore Ray, wrote the introduction to the 1994 edition. And I'm just going to share a little bit of what she wrote in that introduction. She said, "This is not a book. It's more like a friend that'll be there for you when you need to be reminded that you can never be separate from the loving spirit that created you and all of life." Now, we're talking about our true purpose today. And what Myrtle Fillmore said in this book about that is, the real purpose of your life is to express the creation of God, to unfold the many departments of your mind and do what God has planned for you. And that will enable you to know and to do the will of God. So as we learn that we are God's creation, and as we come to understand our oneness with the Creator, we also become more and more interested in studying spiritual things for ourselves. I don't know about you, but it certainly happened with me. So now, as we study, sometimes we get hung up on expectations. But do not be concerned if studying does not always produce the results that you expect. Your spiritual awakening is the most important thing. And that spiritual awakening can take place in many, many different ways. Spiritual awakening will increase your consciousness of your unity with God mind. And that will give you greater freedom of spiritual expression. And as you express yourself spiritually, you shine that Christ light everywhere you go. As you express yourself spiritually, that God light that emanates from within glows around the world. It touches every single individual with which you come into contact. That is the expression of your own spiritual awakening. You know, life is a school. I've always said that life is a learning experience. All of life is a learning experience. And all of creation responds to human consciousness, to that collective human consciousness. So if you have a consciousness of harmony, of peace, of joy, guess what's going to happen? Guess what's going to happen with the people with whom you come into contact? They're going to respond to you with peace, with joy, happiness, and love. So now we pray. We pray and we meditate. We pray for understanding. We pray for spiritual understanding. We pray for that clarification of knowing the divine, knowing the indwelling Christ in ways in which are only known to us. And it only happens on an individual level. We can't teach it to you. We can't give it to you. It cannot be handed to you. It cannot be inherited. This is the work that we do as we study and grow in our own spiritual consciousness. We pray for understanding. We claim our oneness with God. Study your relationship with the Creator so that you may know exactly how and when to lay hold of the abundant life, the abundant intelligence, the abundant substance, the abundant love. For this is how you build these things into your own soul and your own body to perfect expression. And as you do it for yourself, you know you're sharing it with the universe. The perfect body of perfect expression. Isn't that beautiful? So then we learn to declare your oneness with the Creator. It doesn't matter what the appearances are. Learn to declare your oneness with the Creator, regardless of appearances. The Gospel of John, verse 24, chapter 7, says, "Do not judge by appearances, but judge with right judgment." Now, what exactly is right judgment? You know, judgment is a gift, and that gift allows us to use those powers that Charles Fillmore taught us about, the powers of wisdom, the powers of will, the power of understanding, and the power of elimination. That all comes with right judgment. You know, God is all good. God is all good, and we know this. We sometimes forget it, but we know God is all good. And God's power reduces the problems of life to one very simple equation. God is all good. All good equals satisfaction. Therefore, God equals satisfaction. And satisfaction equals life. The 11th chapter of Luke's gospel is just full of wonderful information, lessons to live by. You know, we talk and we pray the Lord's Prayer, and it is in Matthew. That's usually where we get it, the sixth chapter of Matthew. However, it is also, the Lord's Prayer is also in the 11th chapter of Luke's Gospel. So Luke teaches us through that Gospel what Jesus said about how to pray. And then Luke also tells us not to hide our light. Do not hide that Christ light. He reminds us not to light a lamp and put that lamp under a basket, to put it high on a table, in a window so it can be seen. Let that God light shine. And then near the end of Luke's Gospel, he reminds us not to withhold the key, not to withhold the key to God's wisdom and knowledge. He does it in verse 52, where he says, "Woe to you lawyers, for you have taken away the key of knowledge. You did not enter yourselves, and you hindered those who were entering." Now, you know what that means? That means by blocking our light, by not shining our light, by not being the Christ that we were meant to be, we are also blocking the blessings of others. We're blocking the blessings of everyone with whom we come into contact by not shining that Christ light, by not living up to our true purpose, by not being the Christ that we know we are. Do not proselytize. It does not mean you have to go stand on the street corner with a bullhorn and yell and shout and do all of those things that we have seen others do. It does not mean that we go knocking door to door like we know we have seen others to do. What it does mean that we are the light of the world. We are the Christ light. And by being that beacon of light in the world, that beacon of light that silently shows the way, that beacon of light that silently, peacefully, calmly gives reassurance to the world that all is well. That beacon of hope, that beacon of peace, that beacon of love. We assure the world that all is in divine kingdom. Now, we're dealing with this sheltering at home. We're still partially locked down. I know the country is very gradually opening back up, but the bottom line is we are experiencing something which we have never experienced before. We are experiencing a new reality, and it's not going to end anytime soon. So as we experience this new reality, we move forward being that beacon of the Christ, that beacon of light, that Christ light. We shine our light on the world. We remember that two bodies cannot occupy the same space at the same time. And what that means is we cannot walk in love and fear simultaneously. We cannot walk in love and fear at the same time. Either you are fearful or you are walking in love. Either you are shining the light of love and grace and peace, or you are spreading fear and controversy and divisiveness. We cannot do both. So as we move through life and we move through this new reality that we are now experiencing, we continue to definitely use common sense. Use common sense and walk in love. Use common sense as you shelter yourself and your loved ones. Use common sense and grace and peace every time you encounter someone on the street. You know, I find myself, and I've noticed other people have said so as well. We're smiling at people who we do see when we go out, and they can't see the smile because of the mask. However, they can see it in your eyes. So don't stop smiling. Your eyes shine the light of God. And when you smile, even behind a mask, that God light shines through. Be the Christ. Be the Christ. Do not give fear permission to overpower you and to overpower your life. Honor and respect social distancing. Honor and respect all of the rules and regulations that you encounter when you're going in and out of stores and all of those things. But know and know that you know that you know that the Christ is with you. The omnipresence of God never ceases. The omnificence of God never wanes. The omniscience of God never, ever is diminished. Be the peace of God. Live the peace of God. Share the peace of God. And you will have the life of God. Amen and amen. God bless you.
Thank you, Reverend Vernell, for that message. And now we'd like to hear again from Jeff and Linda.
Will I find myself in times of trouble? Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom.
Wake up to the sound of music. Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom. Let it be.
Let it be.
Let it be. Let it be.
Let it be. Whisper words of wisdom.
Let it be.
thank you all for joining us this morning and sharing your tithes and offerings. We do certainly appreciate them. Coming up this week, prayer circle on Thursday at 11. The spiritual discussion will be on Tuesday evening at 7 o'clock. Next Sunday, Reverend Vernell returns with the second part of her series. And again, thank you all for coming. Let's close with our prayer for protection. The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. The presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. Thank you for coming. Thank you for joining us. Stay well, stay safe. We hope to be back in regular service, fairly times soon. So thanks again.